The following presentation is a gift from the team at Streamline Publishing, publishers of Fine Art Connoisseur, Plein Air Magazine, and weekly newsletters Fine Art Today, Realism Today, Plein Air Today, and American Watercolor, and events the Plein Air Convention and the Figurative Art Convention. We offer over 400 different art instruction tutorials and ultra-high-quality video by the world's leading artists. If you like what you see, help us support our artists and our team with your purchase. Each video aired has a special discount code for today only in the comments section with a link to the video offered. And to see everything we do, or if you want to receive notice of new releases, new products, and new events for artists, simply click the other link, which says, "See everything we do." Thank you.
Hi, I'm Eric Rhodes, publisher of Fine Art Connoisseur and Plein Air Magazine. Speaking of Plein Air, one of the best, one of the very best, is Donald Demers. And today, he's going to give you a brief segment of Mastering a Nautical Scene. Enjoy.
Hi, I'm Don Demers. Thanks for joining me. I'm here in Tremont, a small village at the southern tip of Mount Desert Island, Maine, and I'm going to spend some time painting for you today. I am from Maine. I've been painting in New England my entire life, and I've specialized and focused on harbors, boats, maritime subjects, so I'd like to spend some time showing you how to approach this subject in plein air painting. So thanks for coming along, and we'll get started. Okay, let's get started. I've selected a subject matter over here. It's a rather complicated harbor scene. It's got a number of components in it. So my job is to simplify and translate the subject into artistic terms. It's particularly important when you've got subjects that do have complication to them and a lot of detail. So I start with the bigger shapes and the large design, and then I will slowly, as the painting progresses, move the scale of my brush marks and my drawing smaller and smaller and smaller. So you start large and you proceed into a smaller scale. First thing I always do is tone my canvas. Starting out with a white canvas can be kind of disruptive and doesn't give you accurate value judgments. So I pick kind of a local color that I see in the scene. One of the advantages I have today painting plein air is that it's a heavy overcast. It doesn't make for the greatest lighting effect, but what it does is it gives great consistency to the light source. So there's not going to be a lot of movement of shadows. This scene with this overcast lighting is dependent upon well-drawn and designed shapes and careful value relationships. So I'll do this as quickly as I can. I use a fast drying medium. This one happens to be liquin, and this will begin to set up for me. And I'm, again, seeing that kind of neutral gray out there. This is a little bit warmer than the gray I see in the water, but that's fine. There's going to be some overpainting in it. That might cause some interesting color combinations. This is all going to be a series of all neutral tones. A lot of grays out there. I'll talk a little bit about my palette here in a few minutes. I want to get this first scrub in done. This also helps me warm up, kind of emotionally get into the painting. As abstract as it is, there's some, you begin to get a sense or feel for the scene. You're selecting your theme colors. Some painters use complementary underpaintings. I tend to use analogous, or what I call sympathetic colors to the painting. In this area of Mount Desert, it's quite dramatic and beautiful and very diverse. Large dramatic cliffs, intimate harbors, and we've got a beautiful backdrop of purple blue mountain back there. And there's nothing wrong with taking a paper towel if it speeds up the process a little bit. So that's what I'm gonna do. This is a pochade box I'm working off of. I've had this for years. I set my colors up the exact same way every time. Cool colors over here, progressing to warms, primarily the primary colors. I fill it out with a few neutral tones as well. Earth colors, I use a lot of earth colors. But a lot of that is personal choice. What I'm sharing with you today is how I happen to make a painting, along with some of the fundamentals of how paintings should be composed, the construction of a painting, you're building a painting. The next thing I do, and it's extremely important, is I use a viewfinder to compose and design my pictures. After all, a painting is a rectangle. There's a great big world out here when you're working plein air. So it's important to begin to control your design, to look through this at a scale. My subject is quite a distance from me, so I've got to move this a viewfinder to just the right spot to bring that subject matter forward. And once I've got a pretty good sense of where these proportions are, I can begin my drawing. So, the plein air traditions have been around for centuries. There can be a little bit of a misunderstanding about plein air because it seems to be associated with a style. It really isn't associated with a style. It's simply associated with the act of going outside and working from nature firsthand. I use very little photography in my work. I try to go to the source and witness things firsthand. The reason I mention that is when people see me take out a small brush like this, the wind always kicks up when I'm just about to make a careful mark. It seems, wow, that's a stiff breeze. It seems contrary to what they may or may not know about plein air painting. What I'm doing right now is establishing the armature of the painting. I call them the great lines of the composition, the landscape. They can be very rough and crude. And you can see from the wind that it's blowing my arm around quite a bit. So this is the armature, the linear construction of the painting. My paintings tend to look quite realistic and they've got a lot of detail, but that's not the way they start out. They start out with a bigger design. It's time to check for my viewfinder. This appears tedious a bit when you begin, and very often, by the way, I do a thumbnail sketch, black and white thumbnail sketch. I am not doing that today, but it's a practice that I strongly recommend. Well, my freehand has worked okay. I've got the first few lines in the right spot. Once these large puzzle pieces are placed in their proper perspective and proportion, the drawing moves along pretty quickly. That's a complicated backdrop with all those trees, and I'm going to dramatically simplify that in the painting. I'm going to intersect it with the Blue Mountain. Now, there are some painters, they take a big brush, put a lot of paint on, and begin to carve their way around the canvas. I tend to plan my paintings out with this linear construction. So I've got these three boats down here. There are some things in that scene I can maintain and use. There are some things in there I'm going to have to eliminate or change dramatically. That's about all I need for line drawing before I begin to put in my first few marks of this, putting the bow of that black sailboat over there. I've been around boats a long time. I know a fair amount about them. It does help to have a greater knowledge of your subject than just simply the visual aspects of it. Because there are a lot of things out there that aren't going to translate. They don't necessarily make sense to the eye. But if you've got a more academic knowledge of your subject, a lot of things can be explained. So, out there is what this scene is offering me a lot. It's my responsibility to make selections out of it that I believe will make an effective painting. And I know I have to try to encourage a lot of people I work with, a lot of my students, to say, be careful, do your draw, take the time to do your drawing. It's what I call visual veracity. I like to have the students really learn to see things as they are, develop your ability to see. Once you've got your ability to see, you can begin to express and create. So this is all freehand drawing. There are times, and I'll recommend this as well, that it's important to do a lot of measured drawing. Use a grid on the canvas if you need to, a gridded viewfinder. But in this particular case, I'm comfortable enough so far anyway to just simply be moving these shapes in here freehand. And I measure shape to shape. You establish one shape that you believe is accurate and convincing, and you move on to the next. Always give yourself as much information as you can with the next mark you're making. Every painting is an exploration. It's a series of discoveries. And when you're exploring something, you need clues. I'm squinting a lot already just for the sake of simplifying. Developing your drawing skills is so important, particularly when you're dealing with something that has some complicated features like sailing vessels. I've got my mahl stick here. I've had since I was 18 years old. I've been using this thing. I happen to be interested in, fascinated by some of the plein air traditions of the more academic painters. The more, as opposed to the Impressionists. This stricter discipline of working outside is something that's always interested me. I've got a little homemade bridge here that I use. I'll be painting this over this, obviously, but I like to line these things up. This tall vertical is a very important element, visual component in the painting. It helps me make my assessments as to my spatial division. So far, the issues I'm dealing with are spatial arrangement, interesting spatial arrangement, and draftsmanship. There are pilings, those are the vertical posts that surround the float that those boats are tied up to. Whoops. In the actual scene, they're kind of lined up in front of the masts of the vessels. I don't want that, so I'm going to alter them. I'm looking for rhythm, pattern, variation, and I want to avoid visual conflict. I don't want to put, we're translating, this is a big translation. We're taking the real world, the natural and man-made world, and we're translating it into a new language. It's the language of painting. In those translations, some of the elements out there will work effectively, some will not. The things that will not need to be translated and changed. And it's always in service of the idea of your painting. One of the ways I like to say it is take your subject and assign an artistic principle to it. So my subject, obviously, are these boats tied up at the dock. My artistic concept is to have this area of detail and activity that will engage the eye, and it will be contrasted by this simple graphic background to show the natural environment out there, the mountain in the distance, the trees. It's that combination of objects and shapes that intrigue me. And of course, when you're on location, you're always dealing with the tide, and the tides here in this far down east, as they say here in Maine, are extreme. They're probably 10 to 15 foot tides, so my subject matter is going to be moving. So I like to get my drawing down early because it's going to change on me. That's probably about all the drawing I need at this point. There is another vessel back here. It's causing a little bit of visual confusion. So I think I'm going to go ahead and leave that out. So while you're designing, always look at ways to connect the linear structure of your painting. There's one more small hull over here that's kind of interesting. By the way, use your brush as a measuring stick. Identify angles and curves. If you're looking to establish a particular angle in your painting, a great trick is to use your viewfinder. Lay your brush right across the viewfinder, establish an angle, and then move it over to your painting, and you can identify your angles. So these are the first evidence of my visual thinking. Every painting has got thousands and thousands of decisions in them. There's a float out behind this sailing vessel here, this is a Hinckley, by the way. I believe it's a Hinckley. Yes, it is. Beautiful boats that are built up this way. That makes a nice horizontal division of that space and begins to engage the eye. So let me just give you a quick tour, if you will, of these silhouettes and the way that the line work connects these paintings. This is all one shape. They look like separate items, elements, they are, but in terms of their silhouette and their linear construction, I follow these lines. And I look for where these things connect. Even right up this mast, out that float, those are the elements that I look for in a painting that will unify it. And go back here to the same thing. That low arced tree right there. What kind of tree it is, I actually don't know. But that doesn't matter to me because once you start the painting process, it's a green shape. It's not a tree. It doesn't matter if it's a tree anymore. It becomes a green shape. There's a triangle of water back there that's a good lead into the background of the painting. And we're probably there. Now, this is an area of activity. This is a large silhouette graphic backdrop to this activity. Make decisions about what's important in the painting. The vessels and the detail on them is what's important. The water will be of very secondary interest and the sky will be extremely quiet. Don't overactivate every aspect of your painting because they'll begin to cancel each other out. Okay, that's enough of the tedious drawing. Now I want to talk to you a little bit about my paints. Right here, you can see on my palette, I've got side-by-side whites. This is a quick drying white. This is a more traditional titanium white. I mix them together, particularly when I have a subject matter that has a lot of detail and it's going to require me to paint those masts over a backdrop. I don't like just fast drying white because it actually sets up too quickly. So I mix those pretty thoroughly. That's pure titanium. I don't really need that right now. I'm just going to let that be. And I keep a clean palette. Now I'm going to begin to block in shapes. So I use fairly thin paint layers. Is Viridian. Some painters love it, some painters hate it. I've been using it a long time. I find it has great diversity on my palette. I do a lot of kind of classical marine paintings, open sea, and it makes wonderful deep sea greens when it's mixed with cad red deep or alizarin crimson. Sorry, I got something here with the wind blowing around. Alizarin crimson and viridian make a great color. I'm mixing it with some burnt sienna right now and I'm warming it up with a bit of raw sienna. In the theme of visual veracity, that accurate observational skill that I advocate, using a small viewfinder, the hole in the center of a viewfinder is very helpful to identify color. So I've mixed the color that I think is going to be fairly accurate in representing those trees, and I'm putting that spot down on the canvas. And you can either use a viewfinder or just make a small hole to peer through to identify that color. Color has two identities. One is the true color, the isolated color, and the other is the color relativity, how it relates to the colors around it. So you have to be conscious of both when you're working outdoors. Ultimately, color relativity is probably more important, but because I work in a very natural way, I try to find a high degree of realism in my paintings. Finding accurate color is important to me, and I think it's a worthwhile. There, that's more like it. So the squinting is a pretty common and standard. Boy, I can't get that quite dark enough. It's very interesting. I've got to go deeper with that. There we are. That's more like it. Now, don't isolate segments when you don't have to. The bigger decisions are the ones that need to be made early on. I'm going to paint right across that mast, even though I drew it in. I'm going to come back and get that later. So I'm hoping that with the use of my liquid and a thin paint layer, that I'll be able to paint over this later on. Good. Now, I could have started with any segment of this pane to start the block in. I typically go toward one of the darker passages, and so I can get accurate value development in the painting. I see this as one of the major silhouettes in the painting, and it's a good mid-tone for me to start at. It's a little on the dark side. So from there, I can go down and make deeper, richer darks, like in the hulls of the boats. And I can also go up with the value in the sky. So this is a good starting point. I know painters that start with the very darkest dark, and I know other painters who start with the lightest light, but this gives me a good working platform to begin to make decisions. And a lot of this will get altered and changed as I go. But I try to be as accurate as I can. And again, to go back to that concept of every painting is an exploration, this gives me one of the important clues I need to keep going, to build this painting. I tend to mix my paint in very small batches. I don't necessarily recommend it. It's just one of the characteristics that I have in my personality. I think it probably ends up adding some variation and some subtle changes that add to the painting's quality. Now, I'm thinking of this in two ways. One is, yes, I want it to represent the fact that that's a line of trees back there. But more importantly, it's a graphic backdrop. It's a major silhouette that will give the painting graphic strength. It'll give the composition carrying power. You don't need to over-render every aspect of your painting. In fact, I discourage you from doing so. And here's why. This painting is not about these trees. These trees are a minor player. They're part of the stage upon which the subject is set. So I don't want to overstate them. The important part of this painting is actual subject matter, the sailboats. And when I design a painting, I try to design it the way we naturally see, which is one vignette at a time. We really only have the capacity to bring in small amounts of visual information. Yep, looks like there's some activity on the dock. I'm here on a busy fishing pier. The lobster boats will be coming in a little bit later on. There's always a frenetic nature to plein air painting. You want to move through the painting as quickly as you can. But I would recommend proceeding with speed and accuracy. Not making good, clear decisions early on. Oh, here comes some of the working men now. That's a beautiful color back there. That nice analogous color scheme going between the blues and the greens. So my hierarchy, if you will, or my sequence of priorities in a painting, two-dimensional considerations first, the height, the width, the design. Once you've established that, then you can begin to give the painting its depth and the sense of illusion. And all of these shapes will be refined, made more aesthetically pleasing as the painting progresses. Right now in this block-in stage, I want to get them as accurate as I can without bogging the whole painting process down. So now I'm going to move forward a little bit and begin to build the middle ground, very neutral tones. It's an overcast autumn day. The full array of foliage has not presented itself yet. So there's a lot of neutral tones out here. I use two temperatures of each color. So I've got a cool yellow here and a warm yellow next to it. Cad lemon or cad yellow light, either one, and that's a cad yellow deep, or medium I should say, not deep. I do the same with blues. I've got two blues, cobalt and ultramarine, and I actually use three different reds, all different temperatures. I'm building section to section here. At first, you might feel a little bit lost or not quite have a full understanding, but as you lay in more pieces of the painting, everything reinforces each other. I've got to be a little bit more generous with my paint here, get this covered up. My constant squinting. I'm going to go and push a little bit deeper value in there. Oh, I also use a Prussian blue at times. It seems to be a useful color, especially around maritime subjects. There, that's a good deep, rich dark in there. I want to begin to anchor that tree line onto that shore. So one of the characteristics of my method is if my drawing and design are accurate, I don't have to be too particularly timid with my first paint layers. In other words, I'm not refining everything as I'm going. So as I laid this dark in here, you might have noticed that I didn't do it as a perfectly straight line. I wanted to have the natural feel of these trees being planted or growing on that island in a natural way and not a manicured way. And if there's too much rigidity, if you will, or too much formality in the way the lines are put down, it will have a more manicured feel as opposed to a natural feel. Now it's early yet, but I'm in the painting, but I'm already thinking about brush strokes. A lot of this is just plain old what I call housekeeping. You've got to get the thing filled in. But in addition to that, because this is a descriptive tool, I'm beginning to move the brush and the rhythm and both the pattern and the form of the objects. You'll see me do more of this as I develop, but it's already in my mind, the creation of the illusion of the scene. Hi, I'm Don Demers. Thanks for joining me. I'm here in Tremont, a small village at the southern tip of Mount Desert Island, Maine, and I'm going to spend some time painting for you today. Developing your drawing skills is so important, particularly when you're dealing with something that has some complicated features like sailing vessels. I've got my mahl stick here. I've had since I was 18 years old, I've been using this thing. Now, I just had one of the interesting things happen along a waterfront when you're painting outside, and that is that my subject matter just cast off and is now motoring away from the scene. So, you're given a lemon, you gotta make lemonade. What I'm gonna do is use visual memory. I'm gonna put those shapes down as quickly as I can. Visual memory is a big part of working on location. And I will have to manufacture the rest of that bow in the scene. Seems to be a, I'm no stranger to this having occurred. It's happened to me many times. I'm looking at it as it's going by. And for those of you who are prone to using photography, it doesn't hurt to take a photograph of the subject so you can finish it later on. But I'm being a purist out here today and trying to stay devoted to the specific craft or approach of plein air painting. I had observed that there was a slightly darker value on the side of that cabin and slightly brighter on the front. There's three ports or windows in the cabin. I will be able to finish that boat by memory. I'm intentionally not using my mahl stick because I really want to see if I can get some free gestural shapes into this. That's works okay. I'm going to use my value check. If you don't have one of these, you can easily make one with a piece of cardboard, shoebox cardboard, punch a hole or punch a number of holes into them, and you can line them up with your scene and your painting and make color identifications. My color's a little bit deep, not much, but I'm just gonna push it back just a little bit more to make this a little bit more intriguing. That's a very pure purple. Cad red deep, ultramarine blue, and a touch of cobalt blue. White, of course. And I'm going to show you how when I'm adjusting a passage in a painting like this, I don't do it all with one brush. I want a little bit more care and diversity in the way I put this, make these changes.
Now on DVD. To learn more, visit www.streamlineartvideo.com.
Well, that was a segment from the video Mastering a Nautical Scene, and you can get the whole video or learn more about it at lilyartvideo.com. Remember, there's a special discount code in the comments section. Now let's get right to our interview with Don Demers. We're here with Don Demers, and we're here to find out more about what makes him tick, what inspires him. Welcome.
Thank you, Eric.
So what makes you tick? What inspires you?
Well, quite a few things. The sea would be at the top of the list. For some reason, I started, an inexplicable reason, I started drawing when I was a very small kid, 2-3 years old. My mother would remind me that I used to anger her because I'd go into their home office and pull out all the notepaper and draw on it. When that was gone, I'd take the envelopes and I'd draw in the envelopes. And It was my way of communicating. I've never really known why I had such a propensity or an inclination toward drawing.
Were you drawing the sea at that time?
No. The typical stuff that a boy would draw.
Yeah, jets and airplanes.
Jets, planes, tanks, explosions, right. You know, all that kind of stuff.
Right.
And then that morphed into superheroes and hot rods and all those kind of things.
Right.
I was somewhat nurtured in an artistic environment, not by my father, but my mother knew of the Wyeths, and she was an amateur painter. So was her sister, my aunt. And then we started summering in Maine. Or we would take a summer vacation. Summering in Maine suggests that we were wealthier than we were. summer was not a verb for us. And I got to go to the ocean. Prior to that, I remember the very first visit to go to the ocean in Ogunquit, Maine, and the smell of that salt there, it was intoxicating. Yeah. To see a lighthouse, to see a lobster boat, I don't know why I was so compelled by it, but I was. And shortly thereafter, we started to take our vacation in Booth Bay Harbor. That's where I saw my first sailing ships, my first fishing boats. And all of my artistic attention had been taken away from all of the other subjects and redirected toward maritime environment.
Just fell in love with it.
Fell in love with it. Emotionally, historically, I was kind of an odd little kid. I built ship models all summer long in my grandfather's workshop, and my grandmother would stitch the sails for my boat models, and I'd go and see if they would float. And then at night, while my grandparents played cribbage with neighbors, I would sit by the fire and draw one boat after another. And I got these old dusty books from a friend of my grandfather's. He was a retired judge, and he knew a lot about marine history, and he'd lend me one book at a time, and I'd study him page for page until I knew everything I could about those boats.
Really?
That's how I spent my summers as a boy.
Well, I was fascinated when we went out and did a demo with you. You were talking about all the parts of the boat, and you knew all the rigging, and you knew every piece of every boat. And that's where that all started.
That's where it started. Mm-hmm. And you become fluent in nautical nomenclature, and then subsequently I spent many years on boats, and it just becomes part of who you are.
So your mother knew of the Wyeths.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever have an opportunity to encounter them later in life?
I did, yeah. And of course, the Wyeths for me, again, inexplicably, struck deep harmonic chords in me about my emotional feeling toward New England and toward the land. And I pored over those books, not only Andrew, but also Jamie, and of course, NC. And 1991 or 92, we had one of the few Thanksgivings away from New England. My wife and I and our newborn daughter went down to Pennsylvania to the Brandywine area for Thanksgiving to spend it with some relatives of hers. The day before, gray, overcast, quintessential Brandywine, Wyeth Day, we go to the museum. Have a wonderful time. I'm mesmerized as always. We go up to the cafeteria to have a bowl of soup before we leave. And my wife points like this. Look over your shoulder. It's Andrew and Helga. I pushed my chair back, I would have bumped into her. So she said, well, say hi. And I said, not in a million years. You know, I could not speak to Andrew Wyeth. He's just too iconic to me. As I found out many years later, he would have been angry if he'd found out that I hadn't said hello. So he's such an approachable and nice man.
So you later met him.
I never met Andy. I met Jamie,
okay.
and through mutual friends, and got to know a little bit more about the family through various relationships. And when I told Jamie that story, he said, "You should have said hi to Dad."
So, missed opportunity.
It was.
Mm-hmm. So, of course, there's the great controversy about Helga and whether or not there was a romance. So, when you watched him in the cafeteria, what was your impression?
Oh, that's a fun question. Well, she was Rubenesque, glowing cheeks like a peach. It was incredible to see how much life. I could immediately see why he painted her. Mm-hmm. I turned to my wife and said, no wonder he painted her. She's, is it effluvient, I think the word? Just glowing with her complexion. And I got the sense they were good friends, perfectly comfortable with each other.
Enough said. So we have a lot of people who are watching this who are artists trying to get to the next level, mm-hmm. maybe artists who are starting out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What you teach a lot, and you're a very good teacher.
Thank you.
What do you think are the most valuable pieces of advice that you offer somebody at either a stage of starting out or even trying to move up?
Wow. This will have to be off the cuff, because if I were given that question with a little time, I'd ruminate over it for a bit.
That's why we don't give you the question.
Do it if you mean it, if you are serious about it, and if you are impassioned. And people pretty much know if they are or they aren't. Don't worry too much about your flaws, your deficiencies, the things that you can't do. And work very, very hard at it. It is a craft that has a gigantic prerequisite. You really have to learn the fundamental, the rudimentary components of this. You have to learn how to draw. You have to learn how to, and you learn how to draw by learning how to see. First your eyes and then your hands catch up. Examine the world. And if you're impassioned, these are all things you do anyway, but recognize it in yourself. Be fully conscious of who you are and what you're interested in. And look at art. Museums, this is probably an answer that any number of painters would give. Look at paintings. It's a language unto itself. Both in any book you can get your hands on the internet, and go to museums. The difference between seeing a book, seeing a painting in a book, or seeing a painting live is the same difference there as there is seeing a band in concert or listening to them on the radio. To see live paintings is really pretty, to see original work, I should say, is really transformational.
A lot gets lost in the duplication.
It really does. And there's another level of interaction that goes on between a human being and an original painting that simply can't take place when you're looking at a reproduction in a book, just because it's removed a few times. Those are the first things that would come to mind. I'm sure there are many more, but if another one strikes me and occurs to me, I'll be happy to share it with you. And be optimistic. What we do is self-doubt and disappointment are inextricably attached to this process.
Right.
So be kind to yourself. Celebrate your successes. Don't dwell on your failures. That ratio changes as you mature and become a professional. I expect high quality. I demand it. It has to be there. So my criteria has shifted because I've been doing this for a long time and I work as a professional painter. But in the early stages, recognize and celebrate your successes and build upon those, because those things are the things that are probably your personal alphabet, the personal building blocks of the way you will eventually paint. Pay a lot of attention.
I think we all, as we spend time in the journey and we all get exposed to people who are at a higher level, there is this tendency to be apologetic for our poor painting and to beat up on ourselves and to not understand that everybody that is there who has achieved this certain level of success has gone through the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's very important advice.
Good. I hope it's helpful. And I can tell you that because I've drawn and painted from the time I was a boy, I have spent countless hours frustrated, exasperated, disappointed. But somehow or other, there's always been this little light that leads me on to say, well, I'm going to learn how to do this. And when I learn how to do this, I'm going to begin to express myself and paint the kind of pictures that tell me how I feel about this world. And it's been a long time, and I'm just getting to that realm now.
So why do you think you paint?
That's a wonderful question. We all have these certain propensities, you know. I played sports and did all that normal stuff when I was a kid. But my strengths were in two-dimensional art. It was something that I naturally leaned toward. because it was a way to represent who I was. It was a language. I actually had a student who was looking at a whole bunch of sketches of mine. I just was flipping through this big stack of thumbnail sketches, and she said, "Was drawing your first language?" And it took me aback, and I said, "Wow, what a fascinating question." She was in the psychotherapy field. And at first, it certainly took me aback, and as I thought about it more, I thought about it that night, I went back to her the next day and I said, "You know what, I don't know if it was my first language, but it was a simultaneous language. Drawing to me and making marks on paper were as much a way for me to communicate and find my way in the world as talking was. And it was always a cathartic process for me to express something that I had to show. First me and then somebody else." If you want to hear a philosophical or spiritual answer to the question, I can give you that too.
I'd love to.
I think once we are born and separated from our creative source, you can call it whatever you want, we are now a separate entity in this physical world. And we have an innate homesickness. And we find whatever we can to reattach ourselves to our origin. And for creative people, it can be writing, music, dance, whatever it is. It could be science. It can be any number of things. It can be doing charity work. Mm-hmm. You're trying to remove that feeling of separation and alienation. And for me, it has been painting and drawing. I believe that the creative process is a corollary to the fact that we were created. And so it's our effort to mimic or imitate the nature of our being. And I do believe that. Mm. When I've read great literature, when I've heard great music, whatever great means.
So do you sense that you have a spiritual experience when you paint?
Absolutely.
Every time you paint?
No. Sometimes I feel like I'm trying to plant roses with a backhoe. And sometimes I disappear, my self-consciousness vanishes, and I go into a state of, and I don't want to get flowery with all this, but you go into a state of communion. And all communion means is you're attached. You're one with something.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because the last time I heard somebody say that was, I was talking to one of the Russian masters, and many of the painters in Russia, probably most of the painters in Russia, are Orthodox Russians. Mm-hmm. And he told me that painting for him is essentially a full meditative process.
Yes.
He said he used the word prayer, mm-hmm, in his example, and that he felt that it wasn't always there because we all get these distractions, but he felt that that was his form of communication with his maker.
Yes, I would agree with that and subscribe to that 100%. When I am in a state of humility and acceptance and competence, Edgar Payne said it. He said, "Practice, practice, 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 and when you are ready to paint, you will paint." It's a clumsy paraphrasing of his, but I knew what he meant. He said, "Meditate and make yourself ready." And in serious painting sessions, which virtually all of them are for me, I make myself ready, and you hope that you have faith that you will enter that realm. To back it up to a practical standpoint, that's why you got to work like crazy, so that you have the skills, so that that's not an obstacle, that's not a wall that you're walking into, that you've got the facility. And once you're facile, then you have the potential, the opportunity to enter that realm. And I've entered it. And the very best paintings that I've ever made are the paintings I can't remember making. I've thought about it because I keep journals. And I thought, why didn't I write about that painting? Why didn't I write about that painting? And I remember being in the field on a number of occasions when time vanishes. You're in the now, you're in the moment. You know, a lot of philosophers and teachers have talked about that experience. I know I have had that, and I've had it through painting. Painting's been my vehicle for it.
It's like driving the car and being 30 miles down the road and not remembering any of the last 30 mm-hmm. miles.
Yep. It really is a blessing. It's wonderful to have your work have the opportunity to give that to you.
You talked about what our job is. Mm-hmm. You used some terminology when we were talking earlier.
Yes, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Remember what that was?
I do, yeah. I use the phrase life enrichment. And that, I've thought about that, about what our role is in civilization and our community and our world. And I believe that is what we do. I think we can be emotional troubadours. We can show people how they feel because they can't articulate it themselves. We don't show them a decorative picture to fill a wall. Our higher agenda is to show them a human experience that we share. I've had it by looking across a meadow or a bay or a field or a windswept day or a brilliantly bright day, and that person sees manifest on one of my canvases the same experience and says, that's it. And if you can help show someone through your craft how they feel emotionally, intellectually, primarily emotionally, about the world they're living in, you are doing them and yourself and the earth a great, great, great service. We're very fortunate to be able to do it.
I have two paintings in my head that I can't get out of my head. One,
either one of them mine.
Sorry. One which I saw when I was 22 years old before I knew anything about art, but it spoke to me, and it was horribly expensive, but it was stunning, and I could never get it out of my head, and I wish I had bought it, but I didn't have the $25,000 to buy it. And then another was one that was untouchable that I couldn't buy because I saw it in a museum. What for you is the painting that you can't get out of your head?
Wow. Well, there are a few. Immediately, I have to go to Winslow Homer. Fog warning. One of the things that I think is fascinating about a painting is that it evokes all of the other senses. You take for granted you can see a painting. And we as practitioners always become fascinated. We're in love with the visual aspects of a painting. But if you step beyond that, now you've entered another realm. And if you can begin to evoke a sense of smell, sight, sound, something impending, you're now entered a realm of the human condition, the human experience. So that painting by Winslow Homer would certainly be one that has struck a deep, deep, deep chord. I'm going to be a little all over the map with a few of these. And I won't remember the title in this one. Arthur Streeton is one of my absolute favorite landscape painters, Australian landscape painter. He was knighted by the Queen Victoria, I believe. He was absolutely brilliant. I stumbled upon his work by accident. I was in Connecticut, rained out on a painting trip with two of my buddies, Joe McGurl and Bill Davis. We went to the Hartford Athenaeum, and there was an exhibition of Hudson River paintings coupled with Australian landscape paintings. And I turned a corner and saw this 40 by 50 inch painting done from a high point of view looking down over this sun-bleached, hot, hot Australian riverbed. And I had never seen a painting that, it wasn't a painting of something, it was it. I got hot immediately just looking at it. And then, of course, I studied him and read his journals, and it was 105 degrees when he painted it, and he did it on location. And I became completely obsessed with the beauty and his ability to have captured that experience. Another painting, oh gosh, you might catch me on, I'm almost certain it's Rep, and I'm having a temporary brain cramp. Because this painting, my wife had to take me by the shirt and pull me away from it. A portrait of the Russian poet Garshin in the Metropolitan Museum. Have you seen the painting?
No.
It's a tragic story. Garshin was a deeply depressed poet. His father and brother had both committed suicide. And he was a young man, and he ultimately killed himself by throwing himself down a set of stairs. You can't have a more tragic, bleak set of circumstances. Painting's about this big. And I turned a corner. We were on a tour, rare that I was in. It was, and I said, I just let the whole rest of the tour go. I looked into the eyes of that portrait and thought, oh my God, there's humanity living and breathing in that face. And the paint layer is a 64th of an inch thick. How did a human being, through, as the modernists would call them, plastic materials, canvas, wooden sticks with hair in the end, pigment ground into oil. Capture humanity in that face. And I stared at it and ended up, you can't help but well up and, you know, and get very emotional at the pain in that face. And my wife finally came and said, you're going to have to come back and see this painting again sometime because, you know, an hour is enough.
Museum's closed.
Yep.
So what would you like to have occur in terms of what people remember about you after you're gone?
Yeah.
What is it something that maybe we don't know about you that would never come out in the historical searches?
Thank you for asking me that. It's nice to be, see if you can peel away a veil and share that. I have had some deeply rooted attachment to, I've already said this, I'm repeating myself, a deeply rooted attachment to the sea from the time I was a boy. And what it did for me personally was open up, it defied age. It broke the separation between past, present, and future, and it actually puts me in almost an eternal time frame. And the emotions that are welled up and built by watching the repetition of the sea over and over, and what it means. It's life on the edge. It's this place right, but it always amazes me that you could step off a dock onto a boat and you are suspended in an abstraction and you can go anywhere. And it's this rhythm, it's this endless rhythm. I actually wrote it in a song, a harmony set across time between the shore and the sea. And how human beings respond to it, what it means symbolically, what it means emotionally. But for me personally, the depth of emotional response to that, particularly with brooding weather, this impending sense of change, that is universal and eternal. And only the sea and the sky and the shore, that area, can generate this body of emotions, these feelings. Millions of people are attracted to it. And some know it, some don't. But we all know how many seashore resorts there are, and it's not all about having umbrella drinks and laying on a towel. There's something endlessly compelling about that. And if I could spend the rest of my life attempting to manifest these deep emotional responses that I've had toward life along a shore and leave that as a legacy, say, boy, that guy really understood the sea. He knew what the sea meant to human beings with deep truth. I think as painters we have, I'll use the word landscape now instead of seascape, we're inspired by the external landscape, but we really show what our work means through our internal landscape, that filter that it goes through. And if I can marry those, my having spent an enormous amount of time on and by the sea and have it go through my filter and represent it onto canvases so that 100 years from now, great-grandkids could say, yeah, my great-grandpa, boy, he really knew the sea and he's been able to show it to those of us who are here now. That would do it. That would be enough.
Well, that was Don Demers and Mastering a Nautical Scene, and you can learn more about the entire video at lilyartvideo.com. Remember, in the comments section, there's a special discount code. Thank you for watching today. I'm Eric Rhodes.
Hi, I'm Don Demers. Thanks for joining me. I'm here in Tremont, a small village at the southern tip of Mount Desert Island, Maine, and I'm going to spend some time painting for you today. Developing your drawing skills is so important, particularly when you're dealing with something that has some complicated features like sailing vessels. I've got my mahl stick here. I've had since I was 18 years old, I've been using this thing. Now, I just had one of the interesting things happen along a waterfront when you're painting outside, and that is that my subject matter just cast off and is now motoring away from the scene. So, you're given a lemon, you gotta make lemonade. What I'm going to do is use visual memory. I'm going to put those shapes down as quickly as I can. Visual memory is a big part of working on location. And I will have to manufacture the rest of that bow in the scene. Seems to be a, I'm no stranger to this having occurred. It's happened to me many times. I'm looking at it as it's going by. And for those of you who are prone to using photography, it doesn't hurt to take a photograph of the subject so you can finish it later on. But I'm being a purist out here today and trying to stay devoted to the specific craft or approach of plein air painting. I had observed that there was a slightly darker value on the side of that cabin and slightly brighter on the front. There's three ports or windows in the cabin. I will be able to finish that boat by memory. I'm intentionally not using my mahl stick because I really want to see if I can get some free gestural shapes into this. That's works okay. I'm going to use my value check. If you don't have one of these, you can easily make one with a piece of cardboard, shoebox cardboard. Punch a hole or punch a number of holes into them, and you can line them up with your scene and your painting and make color identifications. My color's a little bit deep, not much, but I'm just going to push it back just a little bit more to make this a little bit more intriguing. That's a very pure purple. Cad red deep, ultramarine blue, and a touch of cobalt blue. White, of course. And I'm going to show you how when I'm adjusting a passage in a painting like this, I don't do it all with one brush. I want a little bit more care and diversity in the way I put this, make these changes.
Now on DVD. To learn more, visit www.streamlineartvideo.com.